And Marav ended a little late, so it's just hard to get everything set before the time. And in my haste, tonight is, of course, the last class of the semester. God willing.
We're going to miss it.
Thank you. God willing, we have a couple of plants. We have, sort of. We have coming up for Shavuos night. We're going to have an all-night program here at the shul, of course. There are a couple of options. One option is there's going to be great speakers all night. I'm starting off at midnight with a lecture on the Piasechna Rebbe, rather amazing individual who led a Hasidic group in the Warsaw ghetto throughout the entire Nazi occupation. His name is Kolonimus Kalmus Shapiro. He was the Rebbe of a little town called Piasechna, about 14 kilometers outside Warsaw. And he wrote through the entire Shoah, and he buried his writings underground before he was killed. And they were discovered in 1952 by a Polish construction worker, and they have since been published under the title Eish Kodesh. So I'll be speaking about what he had to say during the Holocaust at midnight, God willing, on Shavuos night. That will be a week from Saturday night, I think.
Yes.
Excellent. And then there'll be speakers all night. And for those of you who are interested, I'll have a chabura in the back, just friends that I learned with. We're going to go through the 11th chapter of Mesilat Yesharim, the chapter on Nekiyut. It's going to be a fascinating night of learning.
What time will be about the lecture? Because
midnight.
Somebody can midnight.
Midnight bidiyuk. Okay. So that's one summer semester, sort of. The other summer semester that I'm kind of toying with is maybe during the 3 weeks we might do a couple of lectures on the Holocaust or on the history of anti-Semitism, something like that. But God willing, we will return with this program in the fall. I'm pleased to tell you that it seems to have been a great success. The response from the course evaluations last semester were really high, and I hope you'll fill these out so we can improve for next fall.
Do you have any pens to distribute?
Pens, right next to you. Perfect. The videos have been amazingly popular. We have, in the neighborhood of, I think, 6,000 people have viewed them worldwide. Yeah, I picked up a new person in the Philippines. There are now 24 people in the Philippines who follow this. Four in Turkey, only two in Russia.
We're in Turkey.
Yeah, but it's just one of those things. Hey, Mayor, go into another room, will you? I can't think properly. Thanks.
We're in Turkey.
Okay. I don't actually. The map doesn't go that detailed, but I imagine it's probably Istanbul.
Istanbul.
Yeah, because I have some friends.
I thought
friends
maybe it was one of my relatives.
Four. Okay. All right. Now, so tonight's topic, a fascinating, powerful topic. We're going to talk about Hannah Szenes, one of the more amazing stories coming out of the Holocaust. It is a story with a sad ending, but at the same time a heroic and very meaningful ending. And it will give us an opportunity to discuss the Holocaust, which is such a colossal event in 20th century Jewish history. I wish we had more time to go on past the Holocaust. Perhaps next spring, when we go over this period of history again, we'll extend it further to the 1967 war and further. But today we're going to concentrate on Hannah Szenes. And before we get to the topic of the Holocaust, I should try to say at least a little joke before we go in, because it'll be hard to say jokes afterwards. So, as you know, I only know 14 jokes, and I ran out of them a long time ago, so I have to recycle them. Did I tell you the joke about Gorbachev's anti-alcohol campaign?
Not yet.
No.
Baruch Hashem. I'm sure I told it to you, but thank God you will forget it. So the joke goes like this. It's a true joke that I actually heard when I was studying for my dissertation in Kiev. At the time, it was at the collapse of communism, and President Gorbachev was trying very hard to crack down on alcoholism in Soviet society. It was running rampant. People were drinking vodka, whiskey, and especially this homemade moonshine called horilka. No, it was called the samohon. Samohon means self-cooked, and it's like you make it in your bathtub. It was bathtub gym, and it caused blindness. It was poisonous often, and it was you know, causing absences at work and all kinds of things. So Gorbachev went on he actually did go on a big campaign to try and, you know, reduce the amount of alcohol consumed in Soviet society. So the joke goes like this. Gorbachev gets a junket of journalists, puts them into a big Soviet Aeroflot plane, and he flies them all to a factory in Siberia to talk to average Russian workers, Tovrichi, about drinking and how dangerous it is. So the journalists join him onto the factory floor, and they go. There's all kinds of people working and so on. He goes up to the conveyor belt, and there's one guy standing working there. And the journalists are with the president of the Soviet Union. And he says to him, Ivan, tell me, do you think a person can have a drink in the morning and go to work? And Ivan says, oh, Mr. President, yes, I think it's possible. And he looks at the journalist and he says, well, Ivan, tell me, do you think a person can have, let's say, 3 shots of Horilka and then go to work in the morning? And he says, no, Mikhail Sergeyevich, yes, I think it's possible. And then he says to him, Ivan, tell me, honestly, do you think a person could have 10 shots of Samohon and still go to work in the morning? He says, you see, I'm working. So the irony of this joke and how it actually fits in a sad way, but nevertheless, permit me this kind of flippant connection, that despite the tremendous suffering that the Jewish people went through in the 20th century, you nevertheless see that here we are. We are still working. We are saddened. We are devastated by the loss to all of our families. Nevertheless, the Jewish people, Am Yisrael Chai, Netzach Yisrael Lo Yishaker, the eternity of Israel is not a lie.
Amen.
So let's look at the life of Hannah Szenes and understand a little bit about the Holocaust. And I want to thank especially tonight's donors, the sponsors, Timur and Clara Feldmar, Norman and Eva Gatti, and an anonymous donor. Thank you very much for everybody clap for making it possible. All these donations go straight to the shul, and they paid for some of the equipment and things like that, so it's really nice to be able to reimburse the shul for using the space and so on. So tonight's talk is about a very young woman. She was only 23 years old when she was martyred at the hands of the Nazis. A Hungarian young woman who was really quite exceptional. And her story is all the more tragic because she so clearly evinced phenomenal potential for the future. In many ways, we know a lot about her because she left behind a diary, and she's kind of like the other side of Anne Frank. Whereas Anne Frank, a very young girl and adolescent, we see the potential of youth. Hannah Szenes was actually all those things, and yet even greater potential was actualized in her intellectual fervor, in her religious zeal, and her common sense attitude to many things. She could have been a great leader of the Jewish people had she merited the possibility of moving on past her 23rd year. Nevertheless, she did make a phenomenal contribution, and in her own words, referring to other people like Maimonides, there are some people who are like stars, that even after the stars themselves have been extinguished, right? Many of the stars we see, they're already dead, but nevertheless, the light continues to illuminate our world. She's like one of those stars herself. Her brief exposure to this world, the nova that she created, really made a phenomenal impact on Israeli society in particular, and of course, the entire Jewish world. Her years are 1921 to 1944. She was a very active young person in the Zionist movement. She left at an early age to go join a kibbutz. She wrote quite a bit of poetry. Some of her poems have become modern Israeli classics, especially Ashrei HaGafrur, which is translated, it's not my favorite translation, but it's so popular it's hard to get away from it, Blessed is the Match. And we'll look at that poem towards the end of the hour and see what it says about Hannah Szenes and her life. And of course, she was a war hero. In a word, she elected to join an elite group of British paratroopers leaving from Yishuv Israel, Palestine. She paratrooped in behind enemy lines, fought alongside Josef Tito, the later president of Yugoslavia when he was a partisan, infiltrated Hungary's borders, hoping to somehow sabotage Nazi efforts there, and she was captured and killed by the Nazis toward the very end of the war. That's her life in brief. What I'd like to do now is basically talk a little bit about her youth up until her aliyah to Israel, and then I'd like to step back a little bit and talk about the Holocaust, because as we often discuss, these lectures are sort of like their biographies, but they're an excuse to speak about the larger trajectories of Jewish history, and then we'll come back to discuss the end of her life. Okay, so let me start with the early period. Her father, Bela Szenes was a well-known and popular Hungarian Jewish playwright. He was well-regarded. His plays were really put on by the biggest theaters, and he was actually quite famous already in his 30s. He had made quite a mark on the Hungarian literary world. One morning, he had some strange premonitions of his death. He mentioned to his wife, Catherine, who survived the war and left her memoirs, that he felt that he had accomplished everything he wanted to in life, and now he felt that it would be possible that he could actually move on. And a few days later, he died, possibly of an aneurysm, leaving behind his wife and his two children, which I think is a suggestion. We shouldn't mention such things. It's probably not a good thing to... Don't give anyone any ideas. But here is Hannah on the left with her brother Georgi. She was 6 years old when he passed away. They were assimilated Hungarian Jews, very conscious of their Jewish identity and proud to be Jewish. Anyone remember who else fell into this category? We talked about Herzl. Very much the same kind of personality. Very proud to be Jewish in an essential sense, but not necessarily in a ritual sense at all. Mr. Lax.
Was Catherine Jewish?
Yes. They often had non-Jewish names. My Hebrew name, as you know, is Hillel, but my slave name is Henry, you know? My slave name, right? Maybe I shouldn't say that. Well, it's on the internet. Anyways. So they were left at a very young age. Hannah was an extremely precocious young girl, known for her very stoic behavior. She had a very serene mentality from the earliest youth, and she was able to bear the anti-Semitism of 1930 Hungary with remarkable equanimity. Her mother had placed her in a private Catholic school because she was really bright and she was, remarkably well advanced in her studies. One of the things about this Catholic school that illustrates something about the nature of interwar Hungary and also the nature of Hannah Szenes in particular is that they had a sliding tuition scale. If you were a Catholic, you paid the base tuition. If you were Protestant, you had to pay double tuition to get into this elite school. And if you're Jewish, it was triple tuition. And now, here in our Jewish day schools, we're much fairer because everybody pays triple tuition.
But, however, yes. After a year,
don't give away my lecture. Sorry, come on,
forgive me.
Right. So what happened was after her father had passed away, they only had so much income, and her mother decided, no, she really can't afford to pay triple tuition, so she was going to pull out her daughter. The teachers at the school protested the policy, and they allowed her to have the generous tuition arrangement of a Protestant girl. So. You get a sense of what the society was like at the time. There are several incidents in her childhood where her genius was recognized by her peers and by her educators. At one point, they had a literary club, and it was customary that girls in the seventh form, which I imagine would be roughly equivalent to seventh grade, so it would be about 13 years old or so, they would elect the president from the seventh form, and the eighth form, which was the highest grade, would be on the editorial board. So she was, as the best writer in the school, elected unanimously to be the literary head, but some students in the eighth grade protested that a Jewish girl should not take that position, and so she was removed from the presidency of that club. A young girl named Maria, not a Jewish girl, came over in tears when she was when she replaced Hannah and begged her forgiveness, and Hannah, was very, very gracious about it by all accounts, that even as a young girl, she accepted the persecution. She would not apologize for it, but she did not rant and rail against it. She was, from her 11th year, she was well sought after as a tutor and had quite a reputation in the school community, where she was regularly paid a fairly high wage by other mothers to have her tutor their children. Ironically, to jump ahead to the end of this lecture, when she was thrown in a Nazi prison in Hungary, there were actually a lot of children in this prison as well, and she ended up teaching all the children in prison while she was there for a brief time how to read and write. I mean, the fact that they could have children in prison itself is amazing, but it also says something about who Hannah Szenes was. At her very young age, only 18 years old, she had made a decision with Gemiras Halev, with complete heart, that she wanted to forward the Jewish cause by making Aliyah. And perhaps we should say for a minute a little about what was her Judaism at this time. She had a very strong love for and attachment to Tanakh. She read Tanakh, the Bible, quite frequently and meditated on it. She loved praying. She was clearly a theist. She believed in God. She didn't like shul very much. In her diary, she comments about how, you know, she goes to shul and people just talk. And it didn't appeal to her at all. And
even
she just did not want to. So she would fit in. So she didn't like going to shul. She said, I can pray to God just as well here in my own home. She remarked on the kinds of things that she suffered from time to time about discrimination, but she says very clearly in her diary that she is completely committed to Judaism. She looks forward to staying with Judaism for the rest of her life, and she was like a religious, religiously spiritually inclined individual, not necessarily attached to the outward trappings of institutionalized religion. At any rate, towards 1939, things became very dire. Of course, Hungary was allied with Nazi Germany. They were both revisionist states that wanted to change the World War I peace treaties and revise the borders. And within very short order of the opening of the border, on September 1, 1939, it became impossible for people to leave Hungary to go to Israel. And that was a crushing disappointment for her. However, she did have one contact in the Jewish agency that was still there. They were packing up to leave. And when she presented herself, the person who was representing the Jewish agency there was a fan of her father's plays, and he had actually one entry visa to Israel, and he said he can give it to her, but she must leave the very next day. She went home, and she told her mother that she is leaving the very next day. Her mother was devastated, but nevertheless, that's what happened. With complete, you know, a complete decision, she left the very next morning to go to Israel. Yes, question?
I think there is the fact that she made Aliyah, mm-hmm. and I saw the 2 weeks ago in Chabad, the diary, the whole life.
Uh-oh.
I knew it from before, 50 years ago, and then, well, she felt a commitment to Zionism.
Absolutely.
Because it was the writing in the war from the Nazis. Although you overlook, and I don't know if you know, I don't know. She had to get a permit to Palestine, she had to be to Mahanutsi. She cannot go just like this and give me a permit.
You're absolutely right. I'm just trying to like condense it within 60 minutes. So I've got, if I give all the details.
That's why she wasn't religious. She belongs to the
Mahanutsi. Yeah.
No, but she also was not terribly.
She was in the sense of.
I agree.
Like me, the Ben Akiva. Was differently.
I'm not going to focus on it because I really want to carry you through material.
Right.
So, with your permission, this is one of the more amazing photographs, I think, of Adolf Hitler. This is Adolf Hitler as a baby.
He actually looks cute.
I wouldn't say that, but it's hard not to think of it. Of course, this is the era of Hitler. We have to speak for a few minutes about the Holocaust. I know that so many of you are very familiar with the general parameters of the Holocaust. I'm just going to take you into a few more details and look for a second at Hungary specifically before we come back to Hannah Szenes. Hitler was actually not German. He was of Austrian background. And his father was a minor postal clerk. He was orphaned at a fairly early age when his father died. And he was a rather rebellious child from his youth. His father had constantly wanted him essentially to get a government job like he had. Hitler had his heart set on being an artist. He was completely convinced that he had tremendous talent. And so when the age came, he left his small town in Austria. He went to Vienna to try and get training in the Vienna School of Art. And he was rejected 3 times. And he was reduced to essentially, you know, standing by parks and doing caricatures and trying to sell landscapes and things like that. And he blamed much of his misfortune on Jews. He felt that somehow Jews had taken his place in the university, Vienna Art School. This was truncated, however, by the eruption of World War I in 1914, which Hitler seized upon, like many Germans, as an opportunity to kind of purge Germany of the dross of weakness and decadence that they had associated with modernism, and to really emerge cleansed and renewed and powerful after one big cataclysmic, you know, confrontation. It didn't turn out that way. World War I dragged on and on. It was extremely brutal. I won't go into the details about the new kinds of technologies that were used and weaponized and the tremendous number of deaths, but all of Europe was completely, it was a complete Weltanschauung change when they realized how far war had progressed and how devastating World War I was. It was at the time called the War to End All Wars, which we laugh at now because we see it was hardly that. But at any rate, what was really key for Adolf Hitler is the this thing they call the Dolchstoß, which is a German term meaning the stab in the back. Essentially, Germany was not doing so badly during World War I. It was a kind of a stalemate between the Allies and the Axis, but Germany had made tremendous territorial gains in Eastern Europe when suddenly Germany on its own, from within, decided it was time to surrender. That the war had gone too far, it was extremely difficult economically, demographically, and so on. And so Germany felt, and Austria as well, that, you know what, it's time to just stop. We'll be the first ones to admit that we were wrong. And they relied on the Allies' sense of dignity and fair play to treat them appropriately after the war. Because it's not absolutely crystal clear whose fault it was that World War I started. It's not a one-sided affair like World War II, where we clearly have villains. We clearly have, imperialism and clear bad guys. In World War I, there was a whole host of reasons why that strange war started. And Germany felt, you know what, we'll be the first ones to be Mavater, to compromise, and, you know, we'll move past this. The German military felt extremely betrayed by this approach. And they were, in fact, completely abandoned by their administration. So much so that all these German troops on the Eastern Front were told by the commanding officers to just make their way home to Germany. They were given no supplies, they were given no money, and German soldiers actually sold their weapons to buy train tickets home. So you can imagine what kind of a disordered, chaotic kind of pullback it was. So many German military were extremely disappointed with their own government, and they blamed the Jews. They felt that Jews and Jewish socialists in particular had undermined the moral fabric of the government, and it was they who convinced the government to surrender in World War I. Hence the Dolchstoß, the stab in the back. This was amplified in Hitler's mind, together with the idea that Jews took his place out of the Vienna Art School, and eventually he was able to amass a huge movement in the Nazi Party, particularly after he was imprisoned for an attempted putsch, the Munich Beer Hall putsch, where it was a rather quixotic attempt to try and take over the country. And although most people thought, you know, it was just crazy to try and take over the country, nevertheless, he was kind of like an extremist who captured the mood of so many Germans, and he became a hero while in prison. It's only 9 months or so stay. He was given a personal chef by a very sympathetic judge. He had his own secretary there, and he dictated his memoirs called Mein Kampf, My Struggle, and it was an instant bestseller. Once he got out of jail, he was a rock star. People felt that he represented everything modern. He was the way the country had to go. And in short order, throughout the 1920s, he successfully campaigned and ultimately became Chancellor of Germany. Yes, Judith.
While his background was Austrian, and he comes out of Vienna, when you talk about this stab in the back concept, are you interchanging Austrian and German?
Yes. Now, Austria and Germany, they were of one mind through much of World War I, and especially coming into World War II. We've all seen, you know, that classic movie, The Sound of Music, that depicts the period of the Anschluss, when Germany absorbed Austria, and many Austrians were extremely enthusiastic about joining, uniting with Hitler, because they felt Hitler is the wave of the future. He's the way to go.
He wasn't from there. He was called a Böhmische Gefreiter.
He came from Bohemia. Yeah, he came from a little small town.
It was not Viennese.
And actually, he was surprised when he got to Vienna. Vienna was a big city, and it had, I think the number was something like 15 to 20% of the population was Jewish. So it was all of a sudden, and of course, the Jews were well established in the arts, the cultural world, publishing, finance. And so everywhere he looked, they were like Jews, and he was really shocked.
And another thing, the problem was in the Balkans. Tinderbox.
Oh yeah, but let's not even start World War One. You're right. Believe me, I spent way too much. Okay, last question that I've really got to go on.
Is anger towards the Jews or the resentments from the art school experience and the anger from the backstabbing experience that led to an anger or hatred? But where was the influence that led to his philosophies that he wrote in Mein Kampf? Cocked out on his own based on his anger?
It's an excellent question. There is a long intellectual tradition in 19th century Germany blaming the Jews. And actually not just Germany, but you have people like Goering and you have Wilhelm Marr, and they're all writing things like the Jews are going to take over our civilization. Heinrich von Treitschke, a very prominent historian, saying that the Jews are our misfortune. You know, maybe you've heard the phrase, die Juden sind unser Unglück. And so he tapped into a tradition that was in the modern period at least half a century old. It goes back even further if you want to look at classical anti-Semitism. But yeah, he was launching himself on a wave that was already rolling. Now I have to be rolling too, because I already see it's 8:02 and I got a lot to say. We'll skip over a lot of this. During the 1930s, tremendous amount of persecution of Jews. And to simplify the process, it appears that from coming to power in 1933 through the beginning of the war in 1939, and especially up until 1941 with something called Operation Barbarossa. I will pause to go into that in more detail. And then finally to the death camps, Hitler moves through several phases in his Jewish policy. The first phase, pre-war, is one of ostracism, of increasing pressure placed on the Jews. The German laws of blood and honor that forbade Jews from working in the civil service or holding teaching jobs or attending public schools and so on. Stamps in the passports, nur für Arier, kind of benches where only Aryans can sit in parks, things like that, with the hope that Jews would emigrate. Jews would simply leave. Unfortunately, there were very few places that were accepting Jews in the 1930s. It was just a perfect storm for the Jews, in that it was clearly time to leave, and there was no country that was accepting them. The high point of that period is, of course, Kristallnacht and the debacle of the St. Louis. That was a ship full of Jewish refugees from Hamburg that was, moored off the ship, anchored off the coast of Miami Beach for about 6 weeks, trying to get into Cuba. But America would not let the Jews land in Cuba because they suspected that, correctly, that from Cuba, Jews would wait 6 months and then apply for an entry visa to the United States. And they were actually all sent right back home to Germany. Let's just pause it, because otherwise I'm going to go way over time. You guys need a better teacher, probably. We'll charge you double for the other lecture.
It's peace in our time. You're quoting Chamberlain.
Peace in our time, excuse me. You're probably right. Peace in our time. It is Chamberlain. Well, Neville Chamberlain says peace in our time, not peace in our day?
No, in our time.
In our time. Okay, excuse me. Oh, this is so hard. I'm going to go back to the ancient period. Okay, so first you have this period of ostracism, of the Jews being sort of pressured, hope that they will leave for emigration. Then there's a period of expulsion, especially after the war begins, where Hitler tries physically to force them into different places. Some were kind of strange, like for example, there was the unusual plan to buy the island of Madagascar and expel all the Jews to that island off the coast of South Africa. Or the Lublin plan that was to set up kind of like a reservation, sort of like the what we have in America for Native Americans, and expel the Jews there. Didn't work very well. Then we get from 1941 to the period of murder. So you have ostracism, and then expulsion, and then finally murder. Murder occurs in large numbers with the attack on the Soviet Union. You definitely have more isolated cases of murder, with Einzelaktionen, individual actions, and the Kristallnacht, of course, is one of the larger of those, but you only have really well-organized mass murder beginning in 1941, which is rather late in the war. Let's go through that a little bit right now. World War II, which is, of course, the expression of two of Hitler's most closely cherished ideals. According to the great historian Eberhard Jägel, Hitler really had two central driving concepts in his life. One was anti-Semitism. It was not an incidental thing that he used as a glue to bring German citizens together. He was not an opportunistic anti-Semite, like, let's say, the Viennese mayor, Karl Luger, who said, who was a big anti-Semite whenever he spoke publicly, but he always made sure to hire Jewish, you know, ministers of finance. And when people asked him, you know, hey, how can you do this? You're a big anti-Semite and you bring Jews into your government. He used to say in German, "Wer ein Jude ist, bestimme ich," meaning, I'll decide who's a Jew. Don't tell me who's Jewish. This guy, he's not really Jewish. I like him, so he's not Jewish. Hitler was not like that. Hitler was not an opportunistic about anti-Semitism. He was really hardcore, you know, in his bones. He's a verbrenner anti-Semite. Sorry. The other big concept was Lebensraum, living space. Hitler really wanted to expand German territory, ideally to the east, because he wanted to move in the same direction that Germany had been, you know, focused for so many centuries towards Poland. And he had his opportunity with World War II, but he had to approach it in stages. And he did so very cynically and very effectively. What Germany learned time and time again is they cannot win a two-front war. Because they're located in the middle of the continent, Germany cannot fight the Russians in the east and the French in the West at the same time. The logistics are too difficult, they don't have the population base, they have to fight one side at a time. So Hitler's plan was pacify his eastern front, right, this side, pacify his eastern front by making a deal with Stalin, and that way he knows for sure he doesn't have to fight to the east, and then he'll attack France to the west. So this is a Norwegian cartoon showing the deal he made with Stalin. And you'll recall, of course, that Hitler and Stalin are on opposite ends of the political spectrum. It's such a disgusting travesty of political machinations to see the two of them entering a deal. But, you know, we should figure it out. Stalin here is the groom and Hitler is the bride. Essentially, what Hitler said was, listen, Mr. Stalin, we both want Poland. Why don't we both simply divide Poland up between us and we'll have a non-aggression pact and we won't attack each other? Stalin foolishly said, that sounds great. And in fact, that's exactly what they did. I'll show you the map in the second slide. Hitler would hang on to it for 2 years. You're shaking your head. Are you shaking your head in amazement or are you shaking your head? How can he say something like that?
Stalin was making time. Stalin was making for time.
So interpretations. There are many interpretations. There are other historians say that Stalin caught totally off guard in 1941. But I don't want to go there because this will be a graduate seminar. And then once Hitler had taken over Western Europe, France and Spain was neutral, and you know, all of Western Europe with the exception of England was taken over. Then he could go back and attack Hitler, which is in fact what he did. So this is the partition of Poland, hapless Poland, which had just been resurrected as a state in 1918. You recall that it was cynically divided up in the 18th century by Germany, Austria, and Russia, and wiped off the face of the earth for almost 150 years. What happened is Germany invades from the west, and they took over the Poznan region. This blue area belongs to Germany. And then the Soviet Union invades from the east, and they take over Belarus, Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, the Baltic states, and part of southern Poland, eastern Galicia in particular. And then this green area, very important for the history of the Holocaust, Hitler renames it. It belongs to Germany. He calls it the General Government. For some reason, they use the French term, General Gouvernement, and it's not clear to anyone what exactly Hitler has in mind. this blue area had a lot of ethnic Germans in it, Volksdeutsche, and so he expelled Jews from here into the general government, and then eventually he would ghettoize them in cities in this region, and later build the concentration camps there. But for the time being, in 1939, it was just set aside as some kind of general administrative territory. During this time, the Jews are concentrated in ghettos, and there's obviously a lot to say about the nature of ghetto life. I'll just point out a few kind of interesting historical perspectives. It's a myth that the ghettos were all closed with walls. In fact, most were not. Most had simply open streets like we have here in America. You could walk straight out of the ghetto on one of 20, 30 streets at any point. However, there was a much more effective border around most of the ghettos, and that was the so-called Schmaltzovniki, or the greasy ones, as they were known. And these are the non-Jews who made a living out of denouncing Jews trying to escape the ghetto. If a Jew tried to walk out, they would shake them down for a bribe, and if they refused, then they would simply turn them over to one of the Germans or one of the so-called Hilfswillige, the volunteers who assisted them in their nefarious tasks. And so most of the ghettos were not actually sealed. They were places of tremendous privation. Emanuel Ringelblum, who was a historian active in the Warsaw Ghetto, he established an organization called Oneg Shabbat, which was, you know, devoted to the task of chronicling on a historical and in a sophisticated scientific manner what was life in the ghetto like. He estimated that in the fall of 1941, there were 14 people for every square meter of residential space in the ghetto of Warsaw. A square meter is about the size of this table here, and that meant that, you know, you had theoretically people sleeping, you know, on bunks on top of each other, and how many people sleeping outdoors. He also estimated in May of that year 150 people a day were dying of typhus. The bodies were simply left in the street. The Chevra Kadisha could not keep up with it by far. They were simply burying Jews in open pits, an absolutely horrific time. There were two different kinds of ghetto mentality, and this is something that, you know, I wish we had more time to go into it. The Nazis had, ironically, a very chaotic bureaucracy. When you look at their internal documentation, they're great at, like, keeping track of things and record keeping and reporting, but they did not have clear directives from Hitler on many key ideas as to what exactly they were supposed to do. Hitler preferred to encourage people to take radical steps, and he rarely issued guidelines. He simply encouraged individuals, and that created a ratchet effect where if you wanted to rise in status, you would propose and enact something that was incredibly brutal, and Hitler would give you the nod, and you would get more status within the regime. So one of those things that was left unclear is what exactly are the Jews supposed to do in the ghetto? There were two philosophies that eventually developed. One was the so-called attritionist school, which is exemplified by Warsaw, where the people who were in charge of the ghetto, the Nazis in charge, believed that the ghetto was simply a holding place to allow Jews to starve. Jews were given rations in the ghetto. An adult male Jew in the ghetto could get 150 calories a day in ration cards. That's absolutely ridiculous. That's like a soda is something like that. Poles were given 750 calories a day, but they, of course, had the advantage that they had freedom of movement, relative freedom of movement. They could go to the farms, they could buy food on their own, and so on. Jews were resorted to all kinds of smuggling, particularly through children and so on, just to get even the most elemental scraps of food. The other kind of ghetto, which we see in Łódź in particular, were so-called productionist ghettos, where those who were in charge of those ghettos felt that, well, no, that doesn't make sense that the Jews should be left here to die. They are a resource. So the Jews in those ghettos were primarily used as slave laborers. And they set up an entirely different culture than Warsaw, where everything revolved around the incredibly valuable work permit. If you had a work permit, then, you know, you and your family had some protection, at least temporarily. Ultimately, of course, the end of all the ghettos was the gas chamber. And that's something what we'll get to in a moment. The big change happens in June of 1941, June 22nd to be precise. It's perhaps the most important date in the entire history of the Holocaust. Not September 1st, 1939, the start of the war, not even 1933 when Hitler came to power. Did I say something wrong?
I just wanted to ask a question.
Okay, make it quick, please.
On the two different types of ghettos.
Yes.
Is there any religious implication that religious ghettos go one way and non-religious ghettos go
I don't think they made distinctions in terms of who was religious or who was not. The ghettos were just geographic, you know, like Bialystok. And religious Jews, non-religious Jews, all lumped in together. Hitler had no concern whatsoever for religion as a determinant of Jewish identity. It was entirely racial. If you had three Jewish parents, you were a full Jew. Three Jewish parents, sounds like today. Three Jewish grandparents, you were a full Jew. If you had three Jewish grandparents, you were a full Jew. Didn't matter whether it was maternal or not, of course. And if you had two Jewish grandparents, you were a Mischling of the Erste Grade, right? Mischling first degree, like a mixed race. If you had one Jewish grandparent, you were a mixed race second degree. And if you were a mixed race second degree, you were killed in the camps. And it had nothing to do with whether you were converted, whether you had married a non-Jew, all irrelevant.
Yeah, Mischlings were soldiers.
Mischlinge, mixed race. So Operation Barbarossa, that was the name that Hitler used for his double crossing of Stalin. And what he did was, in a surprise attack that was extremely successful, Hitler marched into the Soviet Union. This entire orange area is former Soviet territory, where Hitler simply rolled right over these borders, and Stalin was caught totally off guard. He had no troops in place, and Hitler got right to the very borders of St. Petersburg, Leningrad. It was put under siege. He got within a reasonable distance of Moscow, and he held that territory quite late until finally in 1943, the battle was turned at Stalingrad, and then that will be relevant for Hannah Szenes, which we will get to in a moment. Why Barbarossa is so crucial for the Holocaust, as distinct from World War II, is because Hitler set out four mobile police battalions called Einsatzgruppen, A, B, C, and D. And these were made up of soldiers who were not fit for frontline duty. A little bit older, a little bit overweight, eyeglasses, flat-footed, whatever it is. Their job was not to fight the Red Army. They were not Wehrmacht. Their job was to go to all the Shtetlach, the little Jewish towns, to round up all of the Jews, and as well communists, homosexuals, Jehovah's Witnesses, anyone who was on that blacklist, march them out to ravines and then kill them by machine gun fire. Approximately 1.5 to 2.5 million Jews were killed in this matter, including my own family, and I'm sure the family of many of yours who came from Eastern Europe. And this, the Einsatzgruppen murders lasted from the summer of 1941 through the summer of 1942. However, Hitler moved from that otherwise successful murder plan to something even more devious. Oh, here's some picture of the Einsatzgruppen murders. This is actually a stage shot, but I'm going to...
You didn't mention 1940 communist soldiers.
Right, I can only mention so many things. The Einsatzgruppen, or these special commando squads, although they were efficient, it was a very costly psychologically. They were constantly getting drunk. They were getting triple rations of vodka. Outsourcing the work to native Ukrainians, Lithuanians, Latvians to do it for them. And they were constantly being turned over. I mean, it's hard, if you can imagine, murdering people day in and day out and watching the murder process. I'm reading in the archives about one, Christopher Browning actually quotes this in his book, about, you know, this one Einsatzgruppen member said he found it very hard to kill mothers and children at the same time. He felt that was really cruel. So what he did was he would always kill the children first so that the mothers wouldn't see their children die. And that was his idea of a chesed.
Ordinary
people. It's ordinary men. Ordinary men. Good. That's very good. So Hitler moves on. I'm going to skip past this. This is very important. Well, yeah. not enough time. I'll have to talk about this now. So what happens is, in January of 1942, Hitler convenes an extremely important conference. Eichmann took the minutes, so we have a detailed record of it. It was at the resort town of Wannsee, north of Berlin, so it's called the Wannsee Conference. And at this conference, the shortcomings of the Einsatzgruppen murders are discussed, and the Nazis decide to adopt a new experimental method of murder that had been pioneered in late 1941 at an experimental camp called Treblinka, where instead of bringing the murderers to the Jews and then machine gunning them, they would instead collect the Jews in these factory-like, you know, death establishments. The German term was Vernichtungslager, or destruction camps. Vernichtung means to make into nothing. And they were distinct from the so-called Konzentrationslager, or concentration camps, in that the concentration camps, which had existed since the 1930s, were designed for political prisoners, people that Hitler didn't like, mainly non-Jews, and although the conditions there were incredibly brutal, people died of malnutrition, of abuse, they were not designed specifically to kill people. They were designed like prisons. Brutal, awful ones, but prisons. Yes, exactly. All kinds of people Hitler didn't like. The Vernichtungslager, however, were quite different. They were designed to process death. They were designed to collect living people and turn them into dead people as fast as possible, which is one of the most chilling aspects of the Holocaust that makes it qualitatively different from any other genocide that had happened heretofore. Most other genocides are opportunistic. They don't use modern technology. They don't put kind of like Prussian thinking into designing it in the most efficient way. There's a certain element of passion involved. This was basically, you know, BMW, Braun electronics kind of thinking applied to the murder process. And that's what made it so devastating. Six of these camps were set up ultimately: Treblinka, Auschwitz, Sobibor, Majdanek, Belzec, and Chełmno. And they were all designed for this purpose. As the war went on, several of the concentration camps were retrofitted to use their methodology of murder by gas in particular. Dachau, for example, had crematoria installed that were designed to get rid of the bodies as fast as possible. Bergen-Belsen and others followed. Here are the six death camps with these sort of squares around them. These black squares are ordinary concentration camps, which, as I mentioned, sort of morphed towards the end of the war in the model of the concentration, the death camps as well. And what happens from the spring of 1942 is that Hitler starts emptying out the ghettos and sending the Jews to these six death camps in particular, processing them to death. Somewhere in the neighborhood of 3.5 million Jews are killed in this method. I don't have to go through the details of it. I'm sure you're broadly familiar with it. The use of a pesticide called Cyclone B, which is shown here, the delousing process, quote unquote, where Jews were exposed to this gas and killed. The Jews were, unfortunately, diabolically used in their own destruction, the so-called Sonderkommando, who would go in and collect the bodies, transport them for burial or for cremation and so on. There were also, at the same time, I have to get this Hannah Szenes now, but I will mention one last thing. The death camps also featured a Jewish slave labor. So a small proportion of Jews who were deemed especially fit for, you know, the various industrial activities that took place around the camps. All of the camps had little satellites that were various things that the Germans wanted to do. For example, Auschwitz had the satellite camp called Buna, which produced acetone, and so many Jews were simply taken over to work in that factory. And ironically, even though it was only a few kilometers from Auschwitz itself, it was bombed by the Allies. Auschwitz itself was not bombed by the Allies. Very controversial decision, or non-decision. Also Jews set aside for horrendous medical experimentation as well, particularly twins, because you could experiment on one twin and then compare the changes to the other. Jews experimented on to, well, we can go on and on. It's a very dark chapter in Jewish history. Before I get back to Hannah Szenes then, let me ask if there are any quick questions. Well, that's an excellent question. Hitler himself did not like to give orders. He used to get up very late in the day, especially when he was outside of Berlin. He would wake up like 11, 12 o'clock in the morning, you know, in the daytime. He would have a leisurely kind of afternoon, and then he would gather together his people for a long rambling dinner that would go often to 2, 3 in the morning, every night. And at these dinner conversations where, you know, only his closest associates, Himmler, Göring, Goebbels, and so on, would be invited, they would have these talks over cigars and brandies. And someone would say, you know what, we should build camps just for the Jews. And Hitler would say, that's a good idea. And that would be his order. That's one of the things that is very difficult in a lot of the Holocaust revisionist trials, is we don't have a paper trail from Hitler, like writing a memo from Chancellor Hitler to Himmler, do this. He just would allow people to sort of move on these things. The creation of the camps, certainly we can tie to his underlings, to Himmler in particular, head of the SS, even Göring, though, the Wehrmacht, also very much involved. So it's a complicated, chaotic kind of structure that is due in large part to his personality.
Göring was a little bit lenient towards Jews.
In some regards, but he had different aims in the Wehrmacht. Okay, Mr. Lax, the last question, then we'll go back.
Why didn't any of the plans to remove the Jews to, like, Madagascar work? Originally, it doesn't seem like he wanted to kill all of them. He just wanted to get rid of them.
Yeah, they're impractical. And it's not, yeah, he clearly wanted them to be expelled, first of all. He wanted them to go someplace, but there was no easy place to do it. And just think about it for a second. We're talking about, you know, about 16 million people. How do you move 16 million people? You have to first identify them. That's not easy. Just think about, we live in a time where, you know, we have a social security number, you know, and the president can type it into the computer. He knows how many dental fillings I have. But back then, how could you possibly even locate them? And then, let alone find the trains to move them. A tremendous logistics
nightmare. Send them all to Africa or something?
How do you just send them? You can't just say, everybody go.
Force them to leave.
How do you force them to leave? You have to have a soldier. It's a very difficult thing. I gotta move on, or else we won't stay to our agenda. So, back to Hannah Szenes, our heroine. She's in Israel now. She has a dream one night that she goes back to Hungary. She's very worried about the situation with her family there, about the situation with her country. And so the next day she goes and makes inquiries, is there any way that she can perhaps participate in the war effort? Ironically, as it happened, the British were putting together an elite troop of paratroopers where they wanted to get extremely fit, linguistically talented, brave young people to fly into Yugoslavia and then make their way across the enemy lines. Hannah Szenes volunteers. She is examined and trained, and she's accepted for the program, one of 37 candidates. And in fact, she makes the flight to Yugoslavia, and she successfully lands, and as I mentioned earlier, she joined the anti-Nazi partisan group where she fought alongside Josef Tito. Before crossing into the border, she pens one of her most famous poems, the so-called Blessed is the Match poem. She writes it and presses it into the hand of one of her colleagues who's not going across the border and asks him to hold on to it. This is the poem in the English translation that's sort of been canonized. I'll read it out loud. Blessed is the match consumed in kindling flame. Blessed is the flame that burns in the heart's secret places. Blessed is the heart that knows for honor's sake to stop its beating. Blessed is the match consumed in kindling flame. Very powerful metaphor. It's even more powerful in the original Hebrew. For example, one of my students today pointed out it's for honor's sake. The phrase in Hebrew is bakavod, in the honor, as it not for honor's sake, but the heart, as it were, knowing its honor, says, I'm going to stop beating now. Like a match. And I mean, I'm not a literary specialist, but my reading of this poem is that the flame is Hannah Szenes. the flame is she herself, who knows the tremendous risk that she's exposing herself to, that she's going into the belly of the beast to fight the Nazis herself, and that she is fully willing to stop her own heart beating for the sake of the honor, for honor itself. And so it's very ironic that it should be recorded. It's now, we have a security guard on campus. Of course, if you're a reasonable, if you're a good Jewish institution, you have Israeli security guards. And of course, our security guard, you know, Hannah Szenes, this poem, Ashrei HaGafrur. Anyways, what was happening in Hungary was a little bit different. Hungary, as I mentioned earlier, was of course an ally of Nazi Germany. But like many of Hitler's allies, they were somewhat reluctant when it came to all aspects of Hitler's program. Most of Hitler's allied countries, for example, were not completely on board with the anti-Semitic program. Italy is a good example, and Hungary as well, Romania, Bulgaria. And specifically what they're prepared to do is, these countries are prepared to go along with murdering Jews who are non-citizens. So for example, Polish Jews who had fled to France, Vichy France says, hey, take them. Vichy France actually volunteered Jews before Hitler even asked. But they're talking about the Polish Jews. Same thing with Hungary, where the Romanian Jews who were taking refuge in Hungary, they were easily expendable, and they were given to the Nazis right away. But the Magyar Jews, the ones who were so well assimilated to culture in Hungary, who spoke Hungarian fluently, who created Hungarian culture, you know, Admiral Horthy and others were not so thrilled with the idea that Hitler wanted to murder them as well. And so most of these allied countries tried to hold on to their own Jews as long as possible while having no qualms about getting rid of the various refugee Jewish populations. So that meant that the Jews in Budapest in particular existed right up until, tragically, the very last few months of the war, because they were generally protected by the Horthy regime. However, the Horthy regime realized, like most of Hitler's other allies, that after Stalingrad in April 1943, Hitler's days were numbered. It was very clear that once the Red Army got its momentum, the Red Army would push towards the West, and eventually the Americans were getting into the war because of after Pearl Harbor, America was also involved in hostilities, and it was just a matter of time before America landed on the beaches of Normandy, which happened in June of 44, and they would push from the west. Hitler would have the classic German two-front war, and it would be all over within months. So Hungary starts thinking, we have to get off this train now. We have to find a way to sort of, you know, carve our own identity so we don't go down with Hitler's ship the way we did. Hitler was not blind to this. And what ends up happening is in March of 1944, right near the end of the war, Hitler sends in his own troops and he takes over Hungary directly. Hungary stops being an ally of Hitler and is now a puppet state of Hitler, which is tragically the worst possible thing that could have happened to the Jews. Because, and here you see really the elemental level of anti-Semitism of this period, that Hitler was more concerned about murdering the Jews of Budapest than he was with delaying the advance of the Red Army. And he diverted resources. Troop trains were emptied out, and the empty boxes were sent to Budapest to try and murder more Jews, even though that meant that the Red Army would be coming in. I can't think of a better example of the thought of Amalek than this one particular gesture that Hitler demonstrated at the end of the war. Hannah Szenes made her way across the border, and she, with a few of the other paratroopers who were French of origin, were making their way through the villages when there were some passing patrols. And after the patrols had gone, the Nazi patrols had gone, one of the French paratroopers was so distraught that he would be captured that even though they were safe for the moment, he took out his revolver and he shot himself. This attracted the attention of the peasants, who certainly didn't want to be anyone involved with a dead infiltrating paratrooper, and they informed the Nazis, and ultimately Hannah Szenes was captured by this one act of cowardice by her colleague. She was arrested and brought to a prison in Budapest, where she was mercilessly tortured Teeth were removed. She was beaten black and blue, and we can only imagine what other suffering she endured. Specifically, what the Nazis wanted from her was her code for the radio, because she had a code name and she knew other codes, and they wanted to be able to get on the radio and interfere with the movement of the other partisans. She refused consistently to give them any succor in this regard. They knew who she was, and so they arrested her mother, and they threw her mother in prison with her, beating her mother as well, and insisting to Hannah Szenes that her own mother would be killed before her eyes if she refused to give over the codes. Hannah begged forgiveness from her mother, but she still refused to divulge that information to the very end. Ultimately, she was put on trial. She was offered the possibility of asking for clemency. She said that she would be happy to appeal to a higher court, but she would never reduce herself to begging for clemency from murderers, and she was ultimately shot by firing squad. Later, after the war was over, and again, the war was over just a few weeks after she was killed.
8 weeks.
8 weeks after she was killed, the war ended so tragically close to the end. The Israeli government had successfully petitioned to have her body and those of several other paratroopers restored to the land of Israel, where she was reinterred, and her grave is a site of pilgrimage for many Jews today because of the tremendous example of sacrifice and self-sufficiency that she envisioned. May her memory be a blessing for all of us.
Amen.
Thank you very much for your attention this whole semester, and I look forward to seeing you.